Mediterranean. So that he's trying to draw a very sharp distinction when in fact there's quite a lot of connection going on. So I hope that relates to the conference theme. Some Monophysite Christians who rejected the decisions of the Council of Chalcedon that Christ was to be acknowledged as existing in two natures, inseparably united, were described by their opponents as the acephaloi, or headless ones. They received this kind of name in the 5th century when, as the quotation on there says, the supporters of Peter Mongus, Monophysite Patriarch of Alexandria, refused to follow him in accepting the Emperor Zeno's Henoticon, thus being left without a head, so they had no leader. The term became a derogatory label for Monophysites in both Syria and Alexandria in the 6th century. The acephaly loom large in Isidore's narrative of imperial history in the 6th century. In his histories, Isidore sought to draw a sharp line between what he saw as the orthodox population of Visigothic Hispania and the heretical Christians of the Eastern Roman Empire. Partly this was part of his political project of undermining the legitimacy of the Roman Empire, depicting its emperors, Justinian in particular, as enthusiastic supporters of heresy. In an article on historiography in Visigothic Spain, Jocelyn Hilgarth suggested that Isidore's Chronica Maiora was mainly directed against heresy and drew particular attention to Isidore's depiction of the acephaly. And the heresy is mentioned elsewhere in Isidore's corpus. For example, in the Etymologies, Isidore has the following to say. The acephalites are so called, that is, without a head, whom the heretics follow, for their founder, from whom the heresy was originated, is not known. Opposing the three chapters of the Council of Chalcedon, they deny the individuality of the two substances of Christ and preach that there is a single nature in his person. Isidore traces the roots of this heresy to its origins to the rejection of the three chapters of Chalcedon, a point to which he returns in his histories. So it's something that he's concerned about consistently, it seems. Both redactions of the Chronica Maiora, written in the 610s and the 620s, like the Etymologies, make it clear that the acephaly originated in a failure to accept the three chapters of Chalcedon. So this is what he says about the origins in the Chronica Maiora. So it's more or less consistent with the Etymologies. At the same time, there appeared the heresy of the acephaly, who rejected the Council of Chalcedon. They are called acephaly, that is, without a head, because the one who first introduced the heresy is not discovered. By the plague of which heresy, many of the East languish still now. And this final sentence indicates that Isidore saw the heresy as a problem into his own day. So it's not something that's been solved. The first reduction of the Chronica Maiora connected the aftermath of Chalcedon to the rise of the acephaly, but kind of implicitly. In the second redaction of the Chronica Maiora, he makes the connection much more explicit. He draws a much clearer kind of connection between the two. For example, while the chapter that preceded the emergence of the acephaly in the first redaction stated that Alexandria and Egypt languished in the era of Dioscorus, the second redaction further specified that those places rejected Chalcedon. So the table shows what he has to say about the acephaly in the first redaction of the Chronica Maiora, and the second column shows what he has to say about it in the second redaction, and as you can see, there's a lot more. By the time that he wrote the second redaction of the Chronica Maiora, Isidore's no longer content to make the basic point that the emperors were incapable of defending the church and supported heretics, but that they had openly rejected the council and that this had led to further heresies. In the second redaction, the next emperor mentioned, Zeno, is said to have defended the heresy of the acephaly and abandoned Chalcedon. Anastasius I is then said to have adopted the heresy of acephaly and condemned to exile those bishops who defended Chalcedon. He's also said to have found fault with and corrected the Gospels. So Isidore seems to be telling a picture of kind of more, the acephaly are sort of create more problems within the church because the emperors are not doing their jobs properly. Justinian I, the next emperor, was presented slightly better in the second redaction, an interpolation stating that Justin was a lover of Chalcedon and abandoned the acephaly. So apparently the Byzantine empires are not all bad, according to Isidore. Further additions to the second reduction in Justinian's reign throw this into sharper relief. According to Isidore, Justinian received the heresy of the Cephali and compelled every bishop in his kingdom to condemn the three chapters. So Justinian's presented as reversing Justin's positive actions in relation to Chalcedon. The second reduction then reports that the Theodosian and Gaianan heresies appeared in Alexandria. So Justinian's abuse of the church, and particularly Chalcedon, led to new heresy. The first reduction of the Chronica does not refer to any religious matters at all in the reign of Justin II, Justinian's successor. However, the second version reported that Justin II destroyed those who had published in opposition to Chalcedon, ordering the celebration of the memory of the council. And this reaffirmation of orthodoxy is followed by a positive development: the Armenians first take up Christianity. Apparently, according to Isidore, they hadn't been Christian before this point in time. The reign of Justin II is the last in which Isidore mentions Chalcedon and the Acephali, although we've already seen that he stated earlier on that many Easterners continued to languish in this heresy up to his own time. So these interpolations to the second reduction present the Byzantines, with some exceptions, as heretics, supporting the Acephali and undermining Chalcedon, all of which leads to more heresy. Even those two exceptions, Justin the First and Justin the Second, were depicted more positively for specific polemical purposes, because it makes Justinian look worse. It makes Justinian look even more like a heretical adherent of the Acephali and an enemy of Chalcedon. Isidore's negative presentation of Justinian must have been related to the fact that the emperor had sent forces that had established a province in the south of the Iberian Peninsula in the 550s. Political confrontation between the Byzantines and the Visigoths plays an important role in Isidore's histories too. However, while the imperial presence opened up Hispania to Eastern heresy, we'll see that it also opened up avenues for exchange of religious personnel, knowledge, and practices. So Isidore's kind of reacting against contact, but actually the province seems to have opened up the opportunity for connection. Although it contains no specific references to the Acephali, Isidore's De Viris Illustribus sheds further light on his efforts to denigrate Justinian as religiously deviant. Despite his opposition to the Byzantines on religious ground, the text further underlines the impression that Isidore actually knew quite a lot about imperial interactions with the church under Justinian. The De Viris Illustribus contains a number of references to Justinian's role in the condemnation of the three chapters of Chalcedon. As you can see, the quotation is on there. The chapters that follow this in the De Viris Illustribus make clear the opposition that Justinian faced from African bishops. Facundus of Hermian wrote 12 books in defense of the three chapters, while Victor of Tonuna was exiled to Egypt and then imprisoned in a monastery in Constantinople, where he died for defending the three chapters. So he presents Justinian as against the three chapters and African bishops as defending the three chapters. Given Isidore's focus on the resistance of African ecclesiastics to Justinian's policies, it's important to recognize the considerable influence that African doctrinal and theological views had on 7th century Hispania. In the 1950s, Madoff argued that Isidore's writings were heavily reliant on African ideology, that was opposed to the emperor and did not acknowledge the authority of the Second Council of Constantinople, and aimed to save the Council of Chalcedon. More recently, Roger Collins has emphasized the more general influence of African texts on Iberian writers in the 7th century. He even suggests that Isidore's family may have originated from Africa. For many of both the secular and the ecclesiastical texts that have been identified as existing in the Episcopal Library in Seville in Isidore's day, an African origin may be postulated or clearly established. So there's a strong connection to Africa, which also may explain Isidore's opposition to Justinian. Another key to understanding the changes between the first and second reductions of the Chronica Majora is Isidore's interactions with Bishop Gregory, a Syrian adherent of the Acephali, which is recorded in the Acts of the Second Council of Seville. Braulio of Zaragoza, who wrote a biography of Isidore shortly after Isidore's death, considered this episode to be among his subject's greatest achievements. As you can see, he's quite pleased with this. The council was held in 619, in the period between the publication of the two versions of the Chronica Majora. So by increasing the number of references to the heresy in the second redaction, Isidore demonstrated the historical origins and the development of a heresy that was of contemporary relevance in Spain. At the same time, denigrating Justinian is responsible for polluting Hispania with heresy. So his kind of polemical and his pastoral objectives actually complement each other in this on the issue of the Acephali. McCool noted that the use of the label Acephali was not particularly precise, stating that it was used at the Council of Seville simply as a broad synonym for Monophysite. It's highly likely that Bishop Gregory came from the territory that the Visigoths had recently conquered from the Byzantines in southern Spain, as the council was particularly concerned to resolve issues of ecclesiastical organization and discipline that resulted from this kind of regime change. Isidore and his fellow bishops presented Gregory's beliefs as a dire threat to orthodoxy, and therefore, after briefly outlining Gregory's views and their success in persuading him to accept their theological position, they devote a significant amount of space to refuting his errors. However, their characterization of Gregory was almost entirely faulty. As McCool says here, all three of the theological strikes against our Syrian, his sect label as an acephalus, his lack of comprehension of the properties of the natures as laid out in the definitions of Chalcedon, and his theopaschatism are all exaggerated products of imperfect cross-linguistic understanding and of biased reporting in Latin by his Western opponents. So a total misunderstanding, apparently. McCool suggests that partly this misrepresentation was the result of the difficulty of translating Greek theological concepts into Latin, and something that may have been exacerbated if Gregory is more accustomed to talking, kind of working in Syriac, if he was Syrian. However, the bishops of Seville did not lack information about the Monophysites, or at least information about them from their opponents, because Canon 13 of the Council incorporates a long florilegium described as testimonies and sententiae. This was designed to refute those heretics who in their madness confuse the two natures of Christ after the union and insert that in him the substance of the divinity is passible. Following a statement of the Nicene Chalcedonian position and a creedal passage, there's a list of biblical citations from the Old and New Testament. This is followed by patristic proofs from, as they're listed on there, Hilary, Ambrose, Athanasius, Gregory. The specific Gregory is not specified. Pseudo-Basil, Cyril of Alexandria, Augustine, Pope Leo, and Fulgentius of Ruspe. It's also particularly important, given his negative attitude towards Justinian elsewhere, as we've seen, that Isidore, who's likely to have written the Florilegium, drew on the theological writings and edicts of the emperor in compiling the Florilegium. More specifically, Isidore used the Confessio Recti Fidei Adversus Tria Capitula, which was made in 515 for the Council of Constantinople. While clearly reliant on the Confessio and following the same broadly chronological order of proofs, Isidore does not just copy it out verbatim. For example, he's notably much stronger on Latin anti-Monophysite writings, for example, as you might expect. So Isidore engaged creatively with Justinian's compilation in refuting Gregory, merging ancient Greek with more recent Latin authors. This suggests to me that he knew what he was doing. It wasn't just a process of copying and pasting. His depiction of Gregory and his beliefs was not an accident. A as well as the efforts of Isidore and others on both sides, so the Byzantine side and the Visigothic side, to build up ideological barriers between those living under Visigothic rule and the population of the Byzantine province, other initiatives sought to more clearly draw a religious boundary in more practical ways. For instance, the church in Visigothic Hispania redefined the ecclesiastical hierarchy within the province of Carthaginiensis in order to raise the status of Toledo, the capital of Visigothic Spain, over Cartagena, the traditional head of the province, but also within Byzantine Spania. So they try and shift the head of the province to Toledo. They also seem to have founded bishops where there had been none before, setting them up in direct opposition to established bishoprics on the Byzantine side of the border. Finally, the records of the Second Council of Seville reveal that churches that were under Visigothic political authority, but that historically had been under the control of bishoprics within Byzantine territory, were allocated to neighboring Visigothic-controlled sees. All of these brief examples suggest that bishops within the Visigothic kingdom were actively buying into broader efforts to differentiate their church from that on the Byzantine side of the border, in the process creating what we might term an ecclesiastical frontier, that the borders of the two political territories are mapped onto ecclesiastical borders. So avenues for exchange I'm going to look at now. How information might have crossed this boundary. Also, there's a mistake on here, because John was abbot of Biclarum and bishop of Girona, so sorry about that. However, other sources suggest that despite efforts to establish religious boundaries between Visigothic and Byzantine territory, there's considerable movement of religious personnel and ideas across the frontier. Even the writings of Isidore and the records of the Second Council of Seville reflect such exchanges, even if in a rather mangled and one-sided manner. So even though they're trying to attack the Byzantines, that demonstrates a degree of knowledge. So thinking about travel here. Sources reveal several instances of temporary travel by religious personnel. For example, John, a Goth from Scabalis, and later Nicene Bishop of Girona, is said to have spent several years studying in Constantinople from the late 570s. Others crossed the border while engaging in diplomatic missions. Leander of Seville traveled to Constantinople in the early 580s on an embassy, where he's described by his contemporary Gregory the Great as acting pro causis fidei Visigothorum legatio. A letter of Bishop Litianianus of Cartagena to Gregory demonstrates that Leander traveled through Byzantine territory when he returned from Constantinople. There was also repeated contact between both Visigothic Hispania and Byzantine Spania and Gregory the Great in Rome in the 590s, with ecclesiastics acting as intermediaries, while the presbyter Aemilius is recorded as acting as an envoy alongside a civilian official in letters exchanged between the Visigothic king and the Byzantine government in the 610s. So people are crossing the border through the period that I'm interested in. Okay. In addition to these examples of temporary movement, there are instances of more permanent moves. We can start with Bishop Gregory, who may have moved from Syria to Spain as a result of conflict between Byzantines and Sasanians earlier in the 610s. The abbot Nanctus is said to have relocated to Spain from Africa with his monks and been given an estate in Merida by King Leovigild. At roughly the same time, the African monk Donatus also sought refuge in Spain, founding the monastery of Servitanum. He's said to have been accompanied by 70 monks and to have brought with him a very large collection of books. So people are moving, but so are texts with them. Some scholars have related this movement of people and texts from Africa to the Three Chapters controversy, as monks sought to escape the harsh measures of Justinian and his successors, preferring, in the case of Nanctus, to accept the patronage of the Arian Leovigild over staying in Africa. Other examples of migration include Paul and Fidelis, Greek bishops of Merida in the mid-6th century, who you might hear about in the next paper. and their contemporary Martin of Braga, who arrived in Gallaecia from the east, ex orientis partibus navigans, as we heard yesterday. So, movement of people. This is a manuscript illumination. This is supposed to be Gregory the Great. We have already seen how texts written in Africa found their way into Spain, and how people have argued that there's a strong African influence on Spanish, on Iberian literature in the 7th century. There's further evidence of intellectual exchange between Byzantine Spain and Visigothic Hispania, however. Such exchanges provoked considerable anxiety on the part of the Byzantine and Visigothic authorities, and the conversion of the Visigoths from Arianism at the end of the 580s seems to have increased the paranoia of the Byzantine authorities about the loyalty of their clergy. It doesn't seem to have prevented movement, though. Leander met with Licinianus of Cartagena on returning from Constantinople in the 580s, and Licinianus wrote to Gregory the Great asking for a copy of his Moralia in Job as a result. While Isidore of Seville's De Viris Illustribus states that Severus of Malaga, another key city in the Byzantine province, wrote a polemical tract against Vincentius of Saragossa, a Nicene bishop who converted to Arianism during Leovigild's reign. I'm not going to outline the long list of texts originally written in Greek, of which Visigothic ecclesiastical writers made use, but it's clear that the theologians of the period engaged actively with the Greek patristic inheritance, even if that was via Latin translations, epitomes, and florilegia, like the kind that Isidore produced for the Second Council of Seville. It's worth noting, however, that Martin of Braga and Pascasius of Dumium, his student, translated Greek saints' collections into Latin in the third quarter of the 6th century. Such text seems to have been used in teaching, at the same time transforming and further disseminating Greek knowledge to late antique Iberia. So I've got some of the sources I've been referring to are listed on here. Some conclusions. Two recent publications point the way towards further research into Visigothic connections between Byzantium and Visigothic Iberia. So first, this one here by Imo Vanches, I don't know how to pronounce that, I'm afraid, has suggested that Eastern computistical knowledge may have been transmitted to Visigothic writers such as Isidore via the Byzantine province. Second, a text known as the Descriptio Hispaniae, which is this one here by Olestian Andreu, found in a 9th century manuscript from Barcelona, seems to reflect the claims of the Church of Cartagena to predominance over the province of Carthaginensis in opposition to Toledo. These two sources thus replicate the two dominant trends in what I've been talking about, that the Byzantine province played a dual role, facilitating the exchange of ideas and people at the same time as kind of articulating a strong rhetoric of opposition between both sides of the border. All of this should not really surprise us because it replicates patterns that are observable in other fields of activity. For instance, political propagandists on both sides stressed political opposition, yet scholars have consistently emphasized how the Visigoths drew extensively on Byzantine techniques for the presentation and legitimization of rule through court ceremony and other means, for instance. The material record similarly suggests that despite attempts to establish firm borders, to build defenses, the Byzantine province actually acted as a conduit to the exchange of goods with areas under Visigothic control. So the material record shows connection too. Exchange and opposition thus seem to have simultaneously characterized religious relations between Byzantine and Visigothic territories in the late 6th and early 7th centuries, just as they did in the political and economic spheres. Isidore's headless heretics are simultaneously evidence for efforts to distance Christians in Visigothic Spain from their Eastern co-religionists and demonstrative of the failure of those efforts to create opposition. So I've finished. Thank you very much.